It's great to hear that you're all interested in chem engineering or chem bio. And I am sharing my screen. You should all be able to see the welcome to chemical and biological engineering here. Those are all our students, by the way, or faculty members in our labs. My name's Wendy Young, as Brad said. I'm an associate chair in the Department of Chemical and Biological Engineering. Prior to working here, I developed microprocessors at Intel. And so this was me in the clean fab. I was in lithography, and so the lighting there is all yellow, so we don't activate the photoresist. And it's an amazing job. So if you go into chemical engineering or chem bio, you can easily move into micro or into semiconductors. Today, I want to talk about what chemis and chembios do, where we work, what you'll learn, and the program at CU. And I'll try to do this in a timely manner. All right, so there are a lot of biomedical fields that chemical and biological engineers go into. A big one is tissue engineering and biomaterials. Here I've got some depictions of cartilage replacement using hydrogels that are seeded with stem cells. And the way we do this is you take some stem cells from a patient right here, you biopsy out these stem cells, and you digest them, you isolate them, you grow them. So that's the cultivation proliferation. You separate them out. Here we have centrifugation. You seed them in this kind of polymer matrix, which is a hydrogel. And then you implant them, you add some growth factors, then you implant them back into the patient and the stem cells grow, the cartilage, whatever it is that you want to be regrowing. And in some cases, the hydrogel matrix breaks down. In some cases, it just stays there, but the patient regrows what they need. And so this is a very, very huge field. It's a wonderful field to go into. And we've got some leaders in the world working at working on our department. For instance, Christiane Seth, Stephanie Bryant, working on here. You can also go into drug delivery type of fields. Here I've got a polymer. So we would be developing the type of polymer, and it's got some drugs in it in here, as you see. And we want the drugs to diffuse out through the polymer in a timely manner. So you don't just get a huge spike in the drug, that you can take this drug and it will diffuse out in a pretty steady dosage with time. And you can also add lipids and or other things to the outside of this polymer to try to direct it to certain parts of the body so that it will be the most effective possible. So brain tumors, for instance, are difficult to treat with chemotherapy. They often recur locally, and I'm about to show a picture of a brain. So if you're squeamish, maybe look away for a little bit. So one thing that you can do is have this polymer wafer, and you infuse it with chemotherapy drugs, and then you implant it into the brain right here. And it will diffuse out in a lower dosage with time, so you don't have to, it doesn't have to be as invasive. You don't have to put it in as many times. All right, the brain's over. Another field that you can get into is genetic engineering and biotechnology. So here we have these different vectors, and we have this RNA, which is basically a recipe for making a protein. And if you put that recipe, that little snippet of RNA into this vector and then implant it into something, for instance, E. coli, the E. coli works as a factory to make the protein that you've put in here. For instance, it could be insulin. Here it's TPA in case you need some blood thinning. This is a piece of equipment that we've got to help with this process. And also, well, actually, this is for stabilizing drugs. So also stabilizing drugs. And if you want to take a drug to a third world country, for instance, and maybe it's at increased temperature, or you're going to be jostling it around quite a bit, then you might denature your protein. And if you denature it, that changes the structure of it and it no longer works. And so we have to keep the structure of these drugs intact. And how can we do this? We've got some faculty working on different ways to do this. One is by freeze drying it using this lyophilizer. And another way is to embed it in a hydrogel and just kind of freeze it that way. And then when you get there, hit or get it to its destination, you hit it with some UV light, and you then reactivate the protein. And by the way, for this genetic engineering, in our building at CU, we are able to sequence genomes very quickly, even within the same day. We've got a bunch of different genome sequencers. And so we're doing this for different drug therapies and also for biofuels. Nanomaterials. If you're interested in materials and nanomaterials, it's great to go into chemical engineering or chem bioengineering, whether it be for biological, energy, or other materials applications. Here we've got quantum dots. These are very, very small. They can be used in computer screens to increase the brightness. They can be used for a lot of different materials applications and also in the body. So we've been looking at applications to kill these antibiotic resistant superbugs. So they're bacteria that don't respond to typical antibiotics. So how are we going to help patients with this in their body? Well, we could add some quantum dots, and then you control whether or not these are going to be active in an area by using light. And so we've got a light treatment here where it's killing the E. coli. And if you keep it dark, then we see that it's not harmful to anything. So you kind of turn it on and off. We also use quantum dots a lot as markers for detecting cancer and other things in the body. So we could add a little snippet of DNA or RNA to a quantum dot and then put it into the body. And if it attaches to cancer or something else in the body of interest, you can then see where the quantum dot is. And if all of it went through the body, then we know that probably we didn't have that cancer or whatever else you're looking for in the body. Material science and engineering. This is yet another field that is ripe for chem engineers and chem bios. Nanoparticles, semiconductors, this is what I did, and I can tell you it was fascinating. It was really neat to be making these microprocessor chips that are so small that had billions of transistors on it, and to be working on every single layer of the process. We could work on membranes, polymers, these microelectromechanical devices, systems, these MEMS devices, whether it be a gyroscope, in your phone, in your car. Sorry, I'm losing it. For in your car, when the airbag goes off, this is what we have in there. And then labs on a chip, very, very small. Here we've got a dime, and you can see how small this lab on a chip is. This lab on a chip is used to see if you have a type of a strain of flu. So you can use a very, very small sample from a patient to do diagnostics. Polymers and soft materials. So we have a really strong polymer program here at CU. One of our faculty members sold their polymer recipe to Philtech and is or to, I'm sorry, to 3M, and they're using this for Philtech bulk fill fillings. So if you get a filling in the back of your mouth, and it has to be pretty, you know, it requires a lot of polymer in there. Well, they used to have to do multiple iterations because when they would shine it with the blue light here, it would shrink a little bit. But now they're developing these dental fillings that do not shrink when you shine the light on them. Also, polymers for click nucleic acids. So this is really synthetic DNA, which has just a myriad of applications. So it could be for drug delivery. It could be for other diagnostics. It could be for finding things within the body. So DNA itself is very, very, very expensive, but we can make this synthetic DNA where we have these little monomers, and we kind of add them all together in a kind of clicking mechanism, like akin to putting Legos together, so that they form this type of structure that you can make very similar to DNA, and it actually has a lot of the same abilities as DNA, or the same, it does the same types of things as DNA in some instances. And so again, you can use that for drug delivery as one application. Energy and biofuels. I already talked about genome engineering for biofuels. We work with NREL, the National Renewable Energy Lab, for biomass to biofuels applications. And so we're developing different catalysts and different enzymes to try to create biofuels more cheaply. We're also doing work on obtaining hydrogen from H2O and sunlight. The problem with hydrogen is that it's very, very expensive to make just hydrogen by itself. And so if we use sunlight as the energy source to get reactors up to perhaps 1400 degrees, we can separate the hydrogen from oxygen in cheap water and obtain hydrogen. We're also doing a lot of work with NREL on solar cells and dynamic windows. So here we have a solar cell and a dynamic window that changes its shading. And also some of our work is with these solar power plants. So in these, as you can see that this is kind of cupped. And so it's reflecting all of the light onto this line right here, which has a polymer in it, or which typically has liquids in it. But what if we use different granular materials, polymers or other granular materials, ceramics or so on, and we can do the modeling of this? Well, we're able to retain a lot of the heat in here and actually increase the effectiveness of our solar power plant. So where do our students go? Well, a large is biotech and pharma. This is the class of 2018. We had 30% were unknown, with 13% were either unemployed or were working not in the industry, kind of underemployed, for instance, maybe working at just not in the engineering industry of any sort. So we've got pharma, a lot go into pharmaceuticals, biomedical, a lot of our students go biomedical, water environmental applications, semiconductors, oil and gas, quite a few students go into business, materials, chemical and foods, alternative renewable energies is a big one, design, the cannabis industry, research software. Some students go into distilling or brewery, into the government, law, transportation, military. And I think that the take home from this is that you can really market yourself to just about any type of field if you go into this, whether it be biological, environmental, alternative energy, materials, and of course, law, medicine. You can get a medical degree from both of our majors, or you can go pre-med for both of our majors. So what are you going to be learning here? Well, your first year would be computing, math, chemistry, biology, and physics. And this is really what you would do for any of the majors. Then you start to specialize a little bit more as a sophomore. You start to do mass and energy balances, which is just what goes in equals what's going to come out. And fluids, heat transfer. How is heat transferred in all of these different applications? Thermodynamics and statistics. Then we start to get really specialized into chemical engineering and chemical and biological engineering. It's not until your second semester of your junior year that you have to choose between the two. You do your separations, whether this be on the biological side, we have a bioseparations class, or distillation, absorption, extraction, all of those types of separations. Kinetics, this is different types of reactors. And of course, materials and biomaterials. And then finally, your senior year, you're going to be doing design. The first semester of design is going to be a project that the whole class works on. And you could be designing a huge power plant with different heat exchangers, different reactors, different distillation columns, and so on. And then the second semester, you'll be working with a company to work on their specific projects. So you get in 5-person groups, and we've got over 30 different companies that participate. and you work on one of their actual problems. We also have control. So this is how are you can control where or keep a reactor at a certain temperature or control how we have heat going in and out of processes. And of course, you'll be taking technical electives throughout this, whether it be biomedical, pharma, nanomaterials, energy, polymers, law. There are a lot of different technical electives that we have. So our undergraduate program is ranked 15th, or our grad program is 15th, and our undergraduate program is around there. It's very challenging, as our students will attest, but it's also very rewarding because there's nothing like really putting yourself out there and giving your all for something to make you feel like you've really accomplished something. And I think that's a great feeling. We have a biotechnology on East Campus. Right now, about half of the engineering disciplines are on East Campus. It's 1 mile away from the main campus. You can see the main campus here. That's that main engineering building, and this is our biotechnology building right down the street. It's a mile away. We have 2 degrees, chemical engineering, chemical and biological engineering. You can go pre-med in both of these. We are very into active learning in the department. We have a lot of screencasts, which is little movies, clickers, and workshops. We and companies like you to be doing more than beyond just your academics. So it's good if you participate as a TA for a class, or if you're interested in study abroad, take advantage of that. We have 5 different programs. You can go to Spain, Ireland, New Zealand, Singapore, or Australia. We've got programs during the sophomore and junior year. You can get a combined BS/MS. You can participate in Engineers Without Borders if that's what inspires you, but really think about what speaks to you and get involved in something. This could be student groups. We've got a lot of different student groups, ASCHE, biomedical, energy, pharma, Society of Women Engineers. We've got different honor organizations. Research, we have over 50% of our students participate in research, whether it be for class credit or volunteering or paid research. And so you can do this as a volunteer. You can get up to 6 credits for independent study. You can do a senior thesis your senior year if your GPA is above a certain mark, and you can do this for pay. We've got a couple mentor programs. We've got the peer mentor program, which matches freshmen and sophomores with seniors, and we also have the alumni mentor program, which matches sophomores, juniors, and seniors with alumni. And so I just want to finish off with, we're a community, so reach out, and we would love to have you as part of the community. And I'm going to end this for questions on this slide, which has a whole bunch of the different fields that you can go into if you go into this major. And then I'll see if there are any questions.